Hello, good evening, and today this is the second lecture in artificial intelligence. In the earlier lecture we had discussed about the basics of artificial intelligence concepts, and then there were a few items which were pending we could not cover in the first video. Now in the first thing that we will be doing, we'll be covering them, and then we'll proceed with the present day lecture. Now this particular thing that we left with, forward chaining. Forward chaining is data driven method for deriving a particular goal from a given knowledge base and set inference rules. Now there are two methods of coming to a conclusion. In this particular artificial intelligence there are two methods. One is called as forward chaining and another one is called the backward chaining. Forward chaining method is the data driven method, and inference rules, in order to derive a particular solution, we will find out these are the inference rules applied by matching facts to the antecedents and consequences relations in the knowledge base. The application of inference rules results in new knowledge from the consequence of the relations matched, which is then added to the knowledge base. Now this is most important part of this application of inference rules. Now we need to apply the logical reasoning to the concepts, and we need to derive them, and relations are matched. This matching process is the most essential part of the forward chaining, which is then added to the knowledge base. Now the knowledge base is updated. Inference rules are successively applied to the elements of knowledge base until the goal is reached. A search control method is needed to select which elements of the knowledge base to apply the inference rule to at any point of the deduction. Now let us take one example here to understand the concept of forward chaining. We have created a knowledge base. These are the few of the facts. If X croaks and eats flies, then X is a frog. If X chirps and sings, then X is a canary. If X is a frog, then X is colored green. If X is a canary, then X is colored yellow. Fritz croaks and eats flies. Now this is the knowledge base that we have created, and on the, this basis there is a goal here. Fritz is colored white. Now we want to identify this particular value Y out of this knowledge base. We want to get the inference, that is the net result, what will be the out of after analyzing or logically reasoning this particular set of knowledge base, we want to find out what is the color of Fritz, that is what is the value of Y in general terms. Now if we see here in the next slide, forward chaining example, X croaks and eats the flies, then X is a frog. Fritz croaks and eats flies, therefore Fritz is a frog. Now you have to match these two things. X croaks and eats flies. Fritz croaks and eats flies. So therefore X and Fritz and croaks eats then flies. So therefore since then X is a frog, therefore Fritz is a frog. This is the conclusion that we are deriving from here. And secondly, further if we process, X is a frog, then X is colored green. There is another clause there. And if we match these two, Fritz is colored green. Because it has been proved that Fritz is a frog, and also if X is a frog, then X is colored green. It has also been given here. So therefore, matching these two things, we will get Fritz is a colored. So therefore, Fritz is colored Y, and that means Y, the value of Y is green. This is called as forward chain. Backward chaining is a goal-driven method of deriving a particular goal from a given knowledge base and set of inference rules. Inference rules are applied by matching the goal of a search to the consequences of the relations stored in the knowledge base. Backward chaining is a goal-driven approach. Now what is the difference between them? That we will start from the end, that is the goal, and then we will try to derive the goal solution from it. Inference rules are applied by matching the goal of the search to the consequence of the relations in the knowledge base. When such a relation is found, antecedents of the relation is added to the list of the goals and not in the knowledge base, as is done in the forward chaining. Now, search proceeds in this manner until the goal can be matched against the fact in the knowledge base. Remember, facts are simply consequence relations with the empty antecedents. So, this is like adding the empty goal to the list of goals. As with the forward chaining, search control method is needed to select which goal to be matched against which consequence relations from the knowledge base. Now we have to see with the help of an example here, and then that will make the things more clear. Now, in the last example, we were given Fritz is colored by. Now we have to start from this side. X is frog, then X is colored green. This and this, we get X is a frog. X is colored green, X is a frog, Fritz is colored white. From here, X is a frog. And X, now there is another one. X is a canary, X is colored yellow. Therefore, X is a canary. In this particular case, X is a frog, X croaks and eats flies. X croaks and eats flies, X is a frog, Fritz croaks and eats flies. It is already there with us. And then, matching these two, X is a Fritz and Y is green here. Now we can see the knowledge base is also given here for your understanding. The X croaks and eats flies, then X is a frog. X chirps and sings, X is a canary. X is a frog, X is colored green. And X is canary, X is colored yellow. Fritz croaks and eats flies, goal, Fritz is colored white. Now we want to identify. But by using backward chain, we will reach to the solution. The backward chain, now you can see here, we will bring this value here, that is Fritz is colored white and X is a frog. Now we will try to match X is a frog, X is colored green. This is the X is a frog and X is colored green, this one. And X is a canary, X is colored yellow, these two. Now we are going to make this. So X is a frog, X is colored green, X is a canary, X is colored yellow. This X, if we compare these two, we get Fritz croaks and eats flies. This is also given to us. So therefore, from here, X is a frog, X croaks. Out of this, we get X is a frog, and out of this, we get X is a canary. And but X is a frog, and X croaks and eats flies. But we are not given anything related with the canary of this respect. So we are coming to the conclusion: this one, that X croaks and eats flies, and this one, X is a frog, then X eats flies. This way, X is first and Y is green. This is called the backward chaining method. Now the inference engine is a computer program designed to produce reasoning on rules. In order to produce reasoning, it should be based on logic. With logic, engine is able to generate new information in the knowledge contained in the rule base and data to be processed. The engine has two ways to run, batch or conversational. In batch, the expert system has all the necessary data to process from the beginning. For the user, the program works as a classical program. He provides data and receives results immediately. Reasoning is invisible. The conversational methods becomes necessary when the developer knows he cannot ask for all the necessary data at the start. The problem being too complex, the software must invent a way to solve the problem. Request the missing data from the user gradually, approaching the goal as quickly as possible. Now, the guide a dialogue, the engine may have several levels of sophistication, forward or backward chaining. This is the most important thing that we have done. Inference engine has got both the things, that is forward chaining as well as the backward chaining method for inference. Forward chaining, there are a few steps here. We have already discussed these things. Examine the rules to find ones whose if parts is satisfactory, but satisfied by the current contents of in the working memory. Now here, this is the most essential part here, number one. Examine the rules to find out the one by the current contents of the working memory. Now we have to see the compare the first example here. The first example was for the forward chaining, and we were comparing the if part. The dissatisfaction of the if part with the content of the working memory, and then we were making the comparison. Fire the rule by adding the working memory. Now new rules were fired and they were entered into the memory, specified rules. Then the part of the may perform the actions, but then ignored them. So we have done the back forward chaining in this particular example, and the example says, examine the rules. What we have done in the previous example, we have examined the rules and the ones with the if part is compared. That is the most essential part of the forward chain. Next, in this case of backward chaining, check the conclusions of the rules to find out the rules that can satisfy the top goal on the stack. Now, this is the most essential thing here in this particular thing. Process the rules one at a time. Evaluate the conditions on the rules, the if part on at a time. If the condition is currently unknown, if there is not enough information currently known to determine whether the condition is satisfied, push goal to make the condition known and recursively invoke the system. So this way, forward and backward chaining we have done. Now the comparison is also there. The exploration of knowledge has different mechanism in forward and backward chaining. Backward chaining is more focused and tries to avoid exploring the unnecessary paths in reasoning. Forward chaining is, on the other hand, is like an exhaustive search. So there is this is the first difference, that it is the exhaustive search. This is the important point that you have to understand. Now backward chaining systems are good for diagnostic classifications. Forward chaining systems can handle all these tasks. Forward chaining systems include writing rules to manage sub-goals. Various backward chaining systems are automatically managed sub-goals. So this way we have the back forward and the backward chaining. Now let us go with the contents of present day lecture. We will be covering what is knowledge acquisition, expert system development, rules of knowledge representation, rule-based expert systems, characteristics of expert system. These are the few things that we will be attempting in this particular lecture. Now in this particular case, let us start with the knowledge. Knowledge is a theoretical or practical aspect and of understanding and of any subject of our domain. Now we have few terms that we have to understand. Knowledge is theoretical or practical understanding of a subject or a domain. What is domain? Domain is area of expertise, area of knowledge, subject. And knowledge is theoretical or practical understanding. You have to understand this particular thing. Now, practical or theoretical? Practical means, suppose you are a doctor, you have a practical experience. Theoretical, suppose you are a teacher, you are teaching these few fundamentals to the students. Knowledge is also the sum of what is currently known, and apparently knowledge is power. This is the most important point that you have to note down. Now the next point, those who possess knowledge are called experts. Now this is the most important point. We call the persons who have got knowledge, they are called as experts in a particular field. For example, the doctors may have specialization in eyes. The doctors may have specialization in say heart. They are specialized for heart. They are specialized for eyes. So all these are called specializations. It is not necessarily doctors. We can have the advocates also. We can have any type of expert who has expertise in a particular area of domain. Now, anyone can be considered as domain expert if he or she has deep knowledge of both facts and rules. Now, this is the point. This is the point here, you have to note down. Anyone can be considered as a domain expert. Who is a domain expert? Domain expert is someone who has got both the facts and rules to interpret, strong practical experience and practical domain, that you have to understand this. And therefore, area of domain may be limited. It is not that everybody is expert in all the fields. People may be expert in one field and may not be that much expert in other fields. So the expertise in a particular area is limited. In general, an expert is a skillful person who can do things other people cannot. So this is the last point here in the slide. Now, acquiring knowledge. Knowledge acquisition can be regarded as a method by which knowledge engineer gathers information mainly from the experts but also from textbooks, technical manuals, research papers, authoritative sources for limited translation into knowledge base. Understandable by both machines and humans. Now you have to understand this particular thing. Knowledge acquisition can be regarded as a method of knowledge engineer gatherers. Now acquisition means acquiring the knowledge. Now suppose if you are a student and now you are acquiring the knowledge. What is the method of acquiring the knowledge? Listening to the lecture, reading the books, like as it is written here, information mainly from the experts but also from the textbooks, technical manuals, research papers and other authoritative sources of ultimate translation into the knowledge base. What is the knowledge base? knowledge base is the net knowledge that is gained by the user or a engineer, which is understandable by both machines and humans. That is the point here. The persons undertaking the knowledge acquisition, the knowledge engineer must convert the acquired knowledge into appropriate structured format that a computer program can utilize. Now, what you have to do? You have to convert the knowledge that you have gained into a useful program, computer program that can utilize. Ultimate goal of knowledge-based creation of an expert system is to replace the use of human expertise and to replace it with the machines, computer programs or machines. Acquiring knowledge. An important characteristic of knowledge is that constantly changing, the lack of documentation and fact that experts carry a lot of information in their heads makes it difficult to gain access to their knowledge for developing information systems in general and expert systems in particular. So here, lack of documentation, because if we talk about any expert, he has gained the practical knowledge with his own experience. He has learned the things by experimenting himself with his own hands. And the knowledge that is not available in the books, he has gained them with the help of experience. So anybody who wants to gain that particular knowledge must be with that particular expert, and he must acquire the knowledge by experimenting along with him. So here, therefore, the knowledge engineer has devised specialized techniques to extract, store this information in an efficient and expedient manner. Knowledge acquisition. Knowledge acquisition is a labor time intensive process. Currently, knowledge bases for knowledge based systems are crafted by hand. This is a severe limitation on the adaptive deployment of such systems. This is the point that you have to note down here, because knowledge acquisition, KA, this is noted generally by KA, and the labor and time intensive process. You need to spend a lot of time on acquiring the knowledge. The biggest bottleneck is in the system development. Now, if we talk about system development, for designing a system which can acquire knowledge, which can implement knowledge, we have several programming concepts here. Prolog is one such programming concept. Lisp is another programming concept. The full form of Prolog is programming in logic. And in Lisp, we have list processing. So, process the information that is stored in the list, that is called as list. Programming in logic means programming the concepts which are in the form of facts and rules. They are to be processed and they are to be analyzed. And if you see here, the most expensive part is money, time and labor. But ultimately, it is the time and labor. Automating the knowledge acquisition is the ultimate goal. Now, there are five members of the expert system development team. What do you mean by expert system? Players in the, now the topic is players in the development team. What kind of team do we require for an expert system? This is the details regarding this. Now, in the case of designing an expert system, we need to have the domain expert, the knowledge engineer, the programmer, the project manager, the end user. The success of their expert system entirely depends on how the members work together. So, these are the people 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. These are 5 people here, with the help of which we will be able to design an expert system. And all of these are doing different kind of work. And this can be shown with the help of a diagram here. Expert system development team, we have here project manager and project manager. We have a domain expert, knowledge engineer, a programmer. Now, expert system is a sort of a program. Now, all of these people are interacting, end user. Now, this is the end user here. It is interacting with the machine program here. And they have devised, the project manager can interact with the domain expert. And project manager can interact with the knowledge engineer. Project manager can interact with the programmer. Ultimately, they are producing a computational intelligent program. So, this is the overall diagram to represent the players in the development team of an expert system. Now, let us see the domain expert. The domain expert is a knowledgeable and skilled person, capable of solving problems in a specific area or a domain. So, let us see. the first thing, the first component of the players is the domain expert. The domain expert is a knowledgeable and skilled person capable of solving problems in a specific area or domain. Now, everybody cannot be called as a domain expert. Only the specified people or the specialized kind of people who have done lots of experiments and practice, they are called as the domain experts. This person has the greatest expertise in a given domain here. And this expertise is to be captured in the expert system. Therefore, the expert must be able to communicate his or her knowledge. This is the most essential point, no doubt. Be able to communicate his or her knowledge. That is, the domain expert must be able to transmit the data that is hidden inside his brain. Because we cannot, there is no methodology directly available with the help of which we can find out what is there in the brain. But we can, if he communicates, we can write it down, we can note down on our sheets, and then we can program it accordingly. Be willing to participate in the expert system development. Now that this expert must be willing to participate to develop a new machine. Commit a substantial amount of time to the project. So he has to devote certain time, because ultimately the goal of designing a expert system is to form a expert system is to participate. All the participation from the is required from the domain expert, and he has to share his knowledge, communicate. He has to participate, and substantial amount of time is required for the development, because testing part is also there that we have not presently discussed. Domain expert is the most important player in the expert system development team. Now, why he is the most expert? Because ultimately it is surrounded by the domain expert. It is revolving around the knowledge of the domain expert. That is what we have to consider. Now, this is the domain expert. Now, next is the knowledge engineer. The knowledge engineer is someone who is capable of designing, building and testing an expert system. See, the definition of a knowledge engineer is capable of designing, building and testing an expert system. He is the whole designer and builder of an expert system. And the knowledge engineer has the following basic tasks. Interview the domain expert to find out how particular problem is solved. Now, what kind of problem? How to solve the problem? He has to deal in that. To establish what reasoning methods the expert uses to handle facts, rules and decides how to represent them in the expert system. Choose some development software. Okay, so we have to underline this. We have to choose a particular software, because ultimately the design is to be done in a software. By using either we can use MATLAB based on fuzzy logic system, and we can use Prolog system, we can use Lisp based systems. They are more popular in the market. So we can choose some development software or an expert shell to look at programming languages for encoding the knowledge. Responsible for testing, revising, integrating the expert system into the workplace. Now, these are the basic ideas over which a knowledge engineer works. Next is the programmer. The programmer is the person responsible for the actual programming. Now, the programmer is going to do the hand coding or manual work. He is going to do describing the domain knowledge in terms of computer understandable form. Okay, so the programmer needs to have skills in symbolic programming languages such as AI languages such as Lisp, Prolog, OPS5, and also experience in the application of different types of expert system shells. Now, he should basically, the present day environment involves only these two. Prolog is more important here. Nowadays, Prolog is used in design the expert systems. And in addition, the programmer should know the conventional programming. Why is he required to know this particular set of languages? The reason is he will be knowing the basic steps of designing a software. So if he has done some work in these languages, automatically he will be able, because these are slightly tougher languages, and he will be able to deal with them, and he will be able to design the program accordingly, and he will be able to code the knowledge that he has been brought down by the knowledge engineer. Project manager. Project manager is the leader of the expert system development team, responsible for keeping the project on track. The project manager manager makes sure that all the deliverables, milestones are met, interact with the expert knowledge engineer, programmer and end users. Now this project manager, now I have shown in the first slide that project manager is interacting with all. He is interacting with the knowledge engineer, he is interacting with the domain expert, he is interacting with the programmer also. He is giving some sort of guidance to the programmer, he is giving some information to the knowledge engineer, and all these are under the control of a project manager. Now let us see end user. The end user often called just the user is a person who uses the expert system when it is developed. The user must not only be confident in the expert system performance but also feel comfortable in using it. Therefore, the design of the user interface of the expert system is also vital for the project's success, and end user's contribution here can be crucial. Now, who is going to use this? It is the end user. So what are we doing? We are making the expert system as meant for only the end user. Now here end user is just the user, a person in expert system when it is there. User must not only be confident in the expert system performance but also feel comfortable in using it. Actually, what we mean by comfortable in using it is to the GUI must be user friendly enough so that the user can have can interact very easily with the expert system. Now, knowledge and rules. The human mental process is internal and is too complex to be represented as an algorithm. However, most experts are capable of expressing their knowledge in the form of rules. Now, what do we mean by rules in our knowledge? Rules are the rational process of rationalizing the information. Now, how do we rationalize? There must be certain rules. If X happens, then Y is the end statement out of this. So for example, here, if the traffic light is green, then the action is go. So, if then else, what do we mean by if then else? These are the programming aspects that we have already learned in the C and other higher level programming languages. If something happens, then do this. So, we can frame such type of rules in the expert system and then we can run the system. Now, if the traffic light is red, then the action is stop. Now, if you see here, this is a rule, if then rule, if then rule. Here, something is going to happen and then this is the end result. If something has happened, this is the end result here. So, knowledge is represented with the help of rules. Rules and knowledge representation. The term rule in AI, which is the most commonly used type knowledge representation, can be defined as an if-then structure which relates given information or facts if part to some of the then part. So, we have seen in the previous slide, I'll show the previous slide again, it relates with some information here and then the final conclusion is here. A rule provides some sort of description on how to solve the problem. Rules are relatively easy to create and understand. Rules are written in the generally, but it's a programming standard, and we use the rules which are simpler in nature. Complex rules may make the programming concepts a little bit tough to understand. Any rule consists of two parts. If part is called the antecedent, premise, or the condition, and the then part is called the consequent, conclusion, or the action. Let us see again. Now in this, so here, if this is happening, and then this is the conclusion, antecedents and consequence. So here antecedent and consequent, premise and conclusion, condition and action. So we can use any of the terms. We can call it as antecedent and consequent, premise and conclusion. Rules and knowledge representation. A rule can have multiple antecedents joined by the keywords and conjunction or disjunction or a combination of both. Now, how can you combine the rules? In order to combine the rules, we can combine them with the help of conjunction and disjunction operators. We have already read this in the first chapter. Please remember this. Conjunction or disjunction. Conjunction operator is an and disjunction is an or operator. Now here, if there are large number of rules here, then we will be joining them with the help of either or AND operator. We already know the truth table for AND, AND OR. AND is true and will give you the result as true only when if both the propositional variables are having the value true, and it is going to give you the value false when the either of the values are false. So, or both of the values are false. In the case of OR, disjunction, OR, any of the items, any of the variables is true, the result is going to be true. So, what can we can do? We can combine the rules and knowledge representation if and then. We can combine several rules at the same time. We can combine several rules at the same time by using this particular OR or AND. So, this way we can combine. Rules and knowledge representation. The antecedents of the rule incorporates two parts: object, linguistic objects or its value. The object and its value are linked by an operator. The operator identifies the object and assigns the value. The operators such as is, are not are used to assign symbolic value to a linguistic object. Expert systems can be used. Can also use mathematical operators to define objects as numerical and assign them numerical value. Now let us see this particular slide very deeply. Now we will be using this. Antecedents, that is immediately after the if statement of a rule, incorporates two parts: an object and its value. The object and its value are linked by operator. The operator identifies the object and assigns the value. Operators are not is used in the symbolic to a linguistic object. Expert system can also use mathematical operators can also be used. It is not necessary we are going to use only the linguistic operators or symbolic operators. We see. Now if and then, if age of the customer and cash withdrawal, then if age, like let us read, if age of the customer is less than 18 and cash withdrawal is greater than 1000, then signature of the parent is required. So this is the way we have joined them together. This is the rules and knowledge representation here. If this is the operator, age, its value, and again an object, cash withdrawal is an operator, value greater than or less than 1000, so then signature of the parent is required. So, if then rule has been combined with the help of AND operator, but we have here object, operator and its value. Now, rules and knowledge representation. Rules can represent relations, recommendations, directives, strategies and heuristics. Relation. Now, what kind of relation we can express? If the fuel tank is empty, then the car is dead. If the fuel tank is empty, then the car is dead. This is the kind of relation. If there is no fuel, automatically the car will not work. Recommendation. If the season is autumn and the sky is cloudy and the forecast is drizzle. See here, two ends. We are combining here together. This one. Then the advice is to take an umbrella. If this is false, automatically the result is false. If this is false, even if this is true, it is going to be false. If both are true, then only the result is true. Directly, if the car is dead, and see here again, and the fuel tank is empty, then the action is refuel the car. Now next, strategy. If the car is dead, then the action is to check the fuel tank. Step 1, complete. If the step 1 is complete, and now again we have combined here strategy, we can tell the strategy also like this. Say, what kind of strategy? If then, if this is true, okay, the first thing, when there is no, the car is not working, what do? We check the fuel. So what is this? If car is dead, then action is to check the fuel tank. Okay, step 1 is complete, we have checked the fuel. Step 1 is complete, and the fuel tank is full, we have found out that the fuel tank is full. Then the action is to check the battery, that is the second step. Step 2 is also complete. So, this way we can describe the strategy with the help of AND operator. You will see the steps here. AND operator is being used for this. Now here is it. If the spill is liquid and then the spill pH value is less than 6 and the spill smell is vinegar, then conclusion. This is the conclusion from this spill material is acetic acid, that is CH3COOH. Okay, so you have two things to define one thing. If both of them are true, then only this will be true, otherwise you will not get the results. Now, knowledge-based expert systems. In the early 70s, Newell Simon from Carnegie Mellon University proposed the production system model, the foundation of the modern rule-based expert system. Now, present-day environment, they are using the rule-based expert system, which is most efficient, and we can express the knowledge from the experts in the form of rules. Production model is based on the idea of humans solve problems by applying their knowledge expressed as production rules to a given problem represented by problem-specific information. The production rules are stored in the long-term memory and problem-specific information or facts in the short-term memory. Now let us see this. This is a sort of a production system model. In the production system model, we have long-term memory where we will store the production rules, short-term memory we will store the facts, and then we will perform the reasoning. Then the conclusion. Now we can again see this. In the which was production system was there and rule-based expert systems. The production rule is based on the idea that humans solve the problems by applying knowledge expressed in the production rules. Now what we have seen in this one, the production rules are applied on to the and then reasoning is done, then we come to a conclusion. Now basic rule-based expert system, if you see here, now present day environment, this is the rule-based systems, rule, if, then. And rule-based expert systems are there, knowledge-based, rule, if, then, data-based, fact. Inference engine, explanation facilities, user interface and user. These are the, this is the present day scenario of an expert system, and this block diagram shows how the present expert system is designed and developed, and these are the parts or the modules of an expert system. Now if you see here, basic rule of our rule-based expert system, we need to have a knowledge. First of all, we have to gather enough knowledge so that we can frame this rule set. Then we can have a fact table, we can create a fact table for identification purpose. Inference engine is required and explanation facilities and user interface and users. Let me explain this to them one by one. So this knowledge base will have an interaction with the inference engine, and it is the inference engine. What do you mean by inference engine? Inference engine is the logical analysis part of logical part, which is going to analyze the rules and then it is going to help us in framing the end result from the facts that we have. So explanation facility is also there. What do you mean by explanation facility? Explanation facility is something like this. Suppose you go to a doctor and you tell that you are suffering from the symptoms of the disease that you are suffering from. Then he tells that you are suffering from malaria, you are suffering from typhoid, and if we ask him, how did you come to the conclusion? That is the important point, you know now. Explanation facility. This is the explanation facility that is required here. Then we have user interface. User interface is for entering the information into the system, and then we will have a user interface. User will interact with this user interface and then we will have the end results. Now the structure of a rule-based expert system. The knowledge base contains the domain knowledge useful for problem solving. In a rule-based expert system, the knowledge is represented as a set of rules. Each rule specifies a relation, recommendation, directive, strategy or a heuristic and has if condition then action structure. When the condition part of the rule is satisfied, rule is set to fire, the action part is executed. This is the most important part here. And finally, the database includes a set of facts used to match against the if condition parts of the rule stored in the knowledge base. Now let us see how this is happening here. We have already discussed this. Strategy, heuristics, if then conditions. then the selection structure. When the condition part, I have already given you the examples of these things. Knowledge base contains domain knowledge. What is the content of our knowledge base? Knowledge base is nothing but a grouped knowledge from the domain expert, domain knowledge, useful for problem solving. If a rule-based expert system is the knowledge is represented by a set of rules. Each rule specifies a relation, recommendation, directives, strategy, heuristics that we have already discussed in the last slides. Then, if a particular rule is satisfied, then what we do? We fire. And action part is executed. Now, the database includes a set of facts used to match against the if-then part of the rules stored in the knowledge base. Now, continuing with this, we have structure of rule-based expert system. The inference engine carries out. So here we have the inference engine. I have already drawn the, you have already seen the previous diagram here. Inference engine carries out the reasoning, whereby the system reaches a particular solution. It links the rules in the given knowledge base with the facts provided in the database here. And the explanation facility, I have already told you about what is the explanation facility. It is to enable the user to ask the expert system how a particular conclusion is reached and why a specific fact is needed. This is the basic main part where when this is used, the reason for using this particular explanation facility is to make the user believe in the system. Thus, user will not believe in the system if you are not going to give any sort of explanation. How did you come to the conclusion? So this is the most essential part, is explanation facility, that I have come to the conclusion because of this. So, particular conclusion is reached and why a specific fact is needed. Expert system must be able to explain its reasoning and justify its advice, analysis or conclusion. The user interface is the means of communication between the user seeking a solution to the problem and an expert system. Now let us see the common rule-based expert system here. This is the overall diagram here. This is the most essential diagram which we have also to draw. And this diagram shows here, this is the expert system with its knowledge base. This is the fact which is to be compared with the main rule set. And external programs may also be used, external database, inference engine, or explanation facility, user interface, user developer interface, knowledge engineer, expert. Let me explain them one by one. In this, we have already discussed this rule, the knowledge base is required, where we will store the rules and fact table will be there. What are external programs? We can input the information to the inference engine from external programs as well. External database can also be linked with the inference engine here, and explanation facility is provided with the help of inference engine. Then, the user interface for interacting with the user. User can know the explanation given by the expert system through the inference engine. Now, why we have attached this? We have attached this because in future, suppose we want to upgrade the system, so we can upgrade this developer interface, knowledge engineer and expert are part of this particular team, and they can regroup the information, they can add few more information facts into the system, and then they can enhance or enlarge the expert system's capabilities. For example, suppose I have designed a system which can interact with finding out the diseases of say communicable disease only. But suppose later on, if I find that I can expand it further by collecting the information and the database, I can expand it further by making it, but it should have the expansion process. It should have the facilities for expansion. Because here, in this particular, if we do not have a developer interface, we will not be able to expand this. So this is also required. Now the characteristics of an expert system. Expert system is built to perform at human expert level in a narrow specialized domain. Thus, the most important characteristics of an expert system is to its high quality performance. No matter how fast the system can solve the problem, the user will not be satisfied if the results is wrong. On the other hand, the speed of reaching the solution is very important. Even the most accurate decision or diagnosis may not be useful if it is too late to apply. For instance, an emergency when the patient dies or nuclear power plant explodes. Now, this is the most essential part of characteristics that we need to observe in an expert system here. An expert system is built to perform at a human expert level. Say suppose if we are given a question or we are asked a particular query, if a specialized domain expert is asked a particular query and he is not replying in time as stipulated or as required, then we cannot rely on that type of system. Similarly, if we are designing an expert system from the computer programs, then if the computer program is not responding within a stipulated period of time, then such type of expert systems may not be useful and they may not be reliable. That is what we have written here. On the other hand, the speed of reaching a solution is very important. Even the most accurate decision diagnosis may not be useful if it is too late to apply for an instance. Emergency, when a patient dies or nuclear power plant explodes. So you have to think very carefully that the time is a major parameter on the basis of which we will be measuring the accuracy of the expert system. Characteristics of the expert system continues, and here expert system applies heuristics to guide the reasoning and thus reduce the search area for a solution. Now we will reduce the search area, because ultimately if we want to reduce the time frame in which the results are calculated, then we need to identify algorithms or heuristics to guide the reasoning and thus reduce the search area. If we are able to search a particular solution from a small data set, then our results will definitely come out in a faster way. So a unique feature of an expert system is to give the explanation capability. It enables the expert system to review its own reasoning and explain the decisions. So the decisions can be explained with the help of explanation facility that we have. Expert system may employ a symbolic reasoning. When solving a problem, symbols are used to represent different types of knowledge, such as facts, concepts and rules. Further, we should be aware that an expert system is only human and thus can make mistakes. And therefore, expert system built to perform at human expert level also should be allowed to make mistakes. Now, it is not necessary every time the results given by the machine will be accurate enough. It must be comparable and it must be compared by the human experts. And even we can say that human experts also, sometimes they may give wrong results. An expert system knowledge is separated by its processing knowledge base and inference engine are split. A conventional program is a mixture of knowledge and control structure to process this particular knowledge. When an expert system shell is used, a knowledge engineer and an expert simply enter the rules in the knowledge base. Each new rule adds some new knowledge and makes the expert system smarter. Now suppose if some new discovery has come up in the medical systems, now we want to increase the our database from the previous level. We can increase this particular database from the previous level and we can enter new information, and that will make the system more smarter. Or we can devise a new algorithm that can also be entered into the expert systems. Now let us see the comparison. This is the last topic for today. We will be comparing it and human experts, expert systems, conventional programs. Use knowledge in the form of rules, thumb or heuristics to solve problems in a narrow domain. Who? These are the human experts. In case of the expert systems, they are the specialized design expert systems are the specialized design computational machines which can process the knowledge expressed in the form of rules and use symbolic reasoning to solve the problems in a narrow domain. So we use the problem in this symbolic reasoning concept and to solve it in a faster way. That is done by the expert systems. Whereas in the case of the conventional programs, we have processed the data, use algorithms, a series of well-done defined operations to solve general numerical problems. Here in this particular case, we are dealing with the general numerical problems here. And if we want to make a comparison between an expert system and a conventional program, the conventional programs are general number crunching programs. But here, basically they are the programs which are computationally efficient. They are deriving a particular knowledge out of a data set. Now the second point, in a human brain, knowledge exists in compiled form. Okay, so whatever you are learning in different classes, you are learning C, C++, Java, all these are compiled form. everything is being compiled and entered into your brain. In the case of this expert system, they provide a clear separation of knowledge from its processing. Processing method is, methodology is different. Data knowledge concept is totally different. So we have a clear demarcation here. Do not separate the knowledge from the control structures, because here we are only using the ordinary if then else rules. So here we will have, we are not separating them. Capable of explaining line of reasoning and providing the details. If at all we human expert is used, and human expert why he has applied this particular line or this particular set of rule, we can ask him, because the explanation facility, we can, with the help of our own particular language, we can ask them that he is capable of explaining the line of reasoning, why he has done that, why he has adopted this methodology. So this is possible here. Trace is also possible here. I have already discussed this concept of trace in the prologue class. And trace is a methodology with the help of which we will be able to see how the rules are chosen from a set of rules here during the problem solving sessions, and explanation how a particular conclusion was reached and why specific data was needed. So this can be done with the help of trace facility that is available in inference engines. Do not separate, okay. Do not explain how a particular result was obtained and why input data was needed. So we do not have much information regarding that. Next, use inexact reasoning and can deal with incomplete, uncertain and fuzzy information. Permit inexact reasoning and can deal with incomplete, uncertain and fuzzy data. Work only on problems where data is complete and exact. Can make mistakes when information is incomplete or fuzzy. Can make mistakes when data is incomplete or fuzzy. Provide no solutions at all or wrong one when data is incomplete or fuzzy. Enhance the quality of problem solving via years of learning and practical training. This process is slow, inefficient and expensive. The human method of solving a particular problem is always expensive. Can make mistakes. Use inexact reasoning. The reasoning may not be exact. For example, suppose we are having a multiple choice questions and we are not clear with which option is to be chosen. So out of the four options given by the question, if we do not have the conceptual knowledge regarding the topic from where this question has been framed from, we need to find out inexact reasoning. We will give wrong reasoning. Wrong reasoning means you are doing a guesswork and the guess is going to give you a wrong result here. Similarly, here also inexact reasoning is going to give you wrong results. So this is all here. Now last one is the enhance the quality of problem solving by changing the program code, which affects both knowledge and its processing, making the changes difficult. So we have to change the program. So this is all for today, and next lecture we will be covering the rest of the topics which will be required for your midterm.